probably, maybe not reset in the original way to work too long or you do anything. And sometimes it gets to be kind of interesting. And years ago, I found myself, when I graduated from high school, I had a real Iridium high A class of IC. I was taught not to do anything but play the sound, so my folks didn't have the money to buy me a horn, so I bought a little horn early in the morning. And so when I started to take lessons, I didn't have enough money to buy the music. So what happened was the old cornet player in town, his name's Ben Foles, and this rapper was a third cornet player, was John Philip Sousa band. And so when we started, he said, well, if you'll pick up some leaves and stuff from the house and, you know, do some things around the yard, I'll give you lessons. So that suited me fine. And years ago, I had heard Del Stager, she played the Carnival Menace, you know, on the radio. And there was a tune that came out, you know, and it said, hello, hello, the RKO, listen, the optimistic, or the world to go. I mean, probably you guys never heard that before. But that was way back in the 20s, you see. And so I heard him play, and my father was a professional fiddle player, and my mother was a piano player, and she was the first music educator in the public school in Atlantic City. So we had a lot of family things going, stuff like that. So what happened was that I didn't realize that the way that I was taught was the thing that helped me more than any other thing. So Ben would say, well, okay, I'm going to play a note, and I want you to play a note. So he played his beautiful sound, and I tried to play the sound, and you know, a lot of funny things come out of the horn, you know. So I'm a bit of a problem. Anyway, this is how I learned to play. I learned to play Happy Birthday and Funeral Silent Night, Jingle Bells, and I didn't even know what the notes even looked like. And it took me a long time to get enough money to buy a book. And then when we did get the book, the man would say, now, this is the sound. So we pronounced the sound. And then shortly after that, when Trump was going pretty well, he said, I'd like to have you go down and study with John S. Light, who was the first public player for the Superman. And so he had called him up, so I hitchhiked 65 miles every Saturday to go down and take a lesson from him. And so he continued the same thing. I never had any other instruction than just hearing sound. And he would play, and I would play, and he would play, and I would play, and this went on back and forth. So actually what I was doing was developing my ears, you know. And that, I think, was the thing that helped me a good step. And when I was 16 years old, my brother had heart trouble, so I had to start school 1 year early. And so I was in first grade at 5 years old, and then my brother skipped the grade. So when I graduated from high school, I was 16 years old. The band came from St. Louis. It was Don Maxwell. And they were playing at Elitch's Gardens in Denver. Well, fortunately, the first drummer player got appendicitis now. And so what happened was they needed a player, and they couldn't find one. You know, all the guys at Denver, you know, were pretty busy with the orchestra and the NBC and all this and that. And all the theaters, if you remember, I mentioned Bob Ewing, there was this one, all the theaters had and these great big movie things that they had to get out, you know, and they had to rewind it. So there was a stage show, and the Paramount Circuit, there was a Fox Circuit. All these different groups went from town to town, and the musicians stayed the same place. So they, all the trumpet players were pretty busy, and it was not a time like we are now. I mean, there are more trumpet players for jobs like that than there are for jobs than then. You've got a lot of experience by just, you know, because they needed, well, they needed a trumpet player, and so I was able to play for 2 weeks at the Elitch's Gardens. And when I got, they were ready to go to California, I wanted to go going the worst way, but they didn't want me because I was too young. Well, fortunate as it was, I couldn't find anything, so I was fortunate enough to go. And when I got to California, I applied to some very famous guys. Very, very much. And I got into trouble a little bit when get unknown, you know. So my range dropped from about an 8 lap off my seat to another 8 or B plant. So I was over to one of my friends in Trump, and he said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I don't know, but whatever it is, sure it'll work." And so he said, "Well, you know, I'd like to know that because I'm, you know, he was doing the thing with the surgeon." And he said, "What are you doing?" He said, "Well, I don't know. I've been told that I should support my doctor and do all these things." And I said, "He said, that's what you do." He said, "Well, I'll tell you, buddy, if you do that, you're going to blow out the wrong way, so you better relax." So things got started. At that time was the time that I decided that there were some other people that were doing IQs. So I thought maybe it'd be a darn good idea to get into some of that stuff. So I started studying IQ. Was very into the things they were doing, and I started studying some psychology and stuff like that. And I found out that if I could keep my head in the music and in the sound, I was better off. So that's the way that whole thing started out. Now, there's more than one way to skin a cat, that's for sure. And there's more than one way to play a trumpet. And I would say that I would hope that everyone would try some of the things that we're going to talk about this morning, but put everything on the table and look at it. There are so many wonderful trumpet players and trombone players and tuba players in the world today, and French horn players. So I think that we can, maybe there will be some little thing here that you can pick up that might change your concept a little bit. And if it does, it works great. If the darn thing doesn't work, boy, throw it away. That's for sure. So what I'd like to start with this morning is some of the stuff that we get into. And I'm going to do most of my stand-up. I think a lady ran into me here 7 years ago and broke both my legs. And I kind of got into a little bit of trouble. But what I would like to talk about is the business of sound itself and how it works and what it does. So we do know, or maybe we do, or maybe we don't, or maybe we don't think this way, but if you take a trumpet and bang the mouthpiece like this, pitch. That is a pitch. And what do you suppose that note is? What's that? What was the fundamental? Yes. Okay, yeah. Okay, that's the same as that was C, right? Okay. So now what happens on the inside of this instrument is that the molecules, air molecules, are banged tightly in the mouthpiece. And then bang tightly in the bell, and then the molecules bang back and forth like this within the instrument. And what we have now is sets up a standing wave. Now, when we talk about a standing wave, we mean exactly that. You cannot blow a note on the trumpet. You get into all kinds of thinking about that, but you can't blow a note on the trumpet. So what we do is we activate that through the energy, just tapping it, we activate the molecules and sets up the standing wave. And the standing wave means that that wave is in motion, but it isn't going anywhere. If we tap a rope down here and a rope to the corner, and you flip the rope is going to move. You can see the motion of the rope moving, and move that way. But this end of the rope is always this end of that, and that end of the rope is always that end of the rope, and there we motion is there, but the wave is staying in the horn. It stays in the horn. And indicating that you can't blow the note out of the trumpet. Now, then we have to, if that's the case, and we can't blow the note out of the horn, what kind of energy do we have that transfers this activity to our ears? So if you had a big board and you dropped it in a pond of water, the heavy weight of the board was pushed down this way and would come back up. and then the former ring, as the energy of the bar goes down again and comes back, the first ring is the first ring and remains the first ring. The energy from the first ring produces the second ring, and it goes up and down again, and there's the third ring. As long as we have enough magnitude of energy to put this power up and down, and we've increased the energy enough, there'll be new rings. But the water, pardon me, the water that is under the board stays there. I mean, it does not move out this way. There's a certain motion within that area that it moves, but it does not move out this way. And if you all live close to the ocean here, and if you've seen a log or some debris in the ocean, and the wave comes up and picks up the debris, well, what happens to that? What happens to the log out there? Does it come back down in the same place, or does it move into shore? It might move into shore if it gets hooked up on top of that guy, right? So what happens is we know now that the water that was out there underneath that log is in that general area. And all the wave that we see is new water all the time. Okay? And there is a certain motion with the water on the shore, but the water doesn't travel from California to Hawaii. Okay? So indicating that that water is the same as the water there this morning. Okay? Okay? Another means of the way in which the sound stays in the horn. So I have some, there's been an awful lot of books written about how to play the trumpet. And a lot of them have lots of great information. And sometimes a person can become a little bit confused by what you read, because maybe you don't read into what the author puts in the book. In other words, you're not quite sure. So it's kind of a difficult thing. There's been many people asking me to write a book, and I have very, very about that, because I don't think you can write that stuff in a book. It has to be a transfer of energy like that. Now, let's talk about how this sound thing travels. If you've seen a toy store, you've seen five steel balls hanging down on a string, right? Have you seen that? When you pull out one steel ball and bang, this bunch of steel balls, what happens? The one on the other side goes out. You pull two steel balls out, right? And two go out, right? What kind of energy is passing through these steel balls? What? Kinetic. That's right. Kinetic energy is passing through those steel balls. And so if we can make the physics of this thing a little bit more so you'll understand, if we get into real physics of sound and stuff like that, we could be here for 2 weeks, 10 hours a day, and still have a lot to go by. But if we can imagine that now that these air molecules in the room here are steel balls, right? Okay? And so you pull out this steel ball and bang this string of steel balls over about there, something like that. And then your activity, since there are no more steel balls in your head, this eardrum is banging back and forth like that. Okay? Doing the same thing that happens on the inside of my mouth or with trumpet sound that's carried through your ears through kinetic energy. And anytime the source of energy stops, then there's no more sound. So it does go, but it does move that way. And a lot of people will say, why in the world do you talk about that? Well, the reason we talk about that is that if we feel like that we are moving the air through the instrument, then we don't feel like we're going to blow a note out of there. And it makes it lots easier for the person to perform what he's supposed to be performing. Now, does anybody have any questions about the steel ball? Are you ready to go ahead? Bob? Okay, all right. Well, now let's talk about energy just a little bit. We see lightning. You're looking very intelligent, sorry. George, what is lightning? Is lightning released energy? Well, can you see electricity? It's lightning, you can see electricity. I won't disagree with you very much. Lightning is fire. It's air burning, okay? Now what happens now is that when the air is burned up here, what do we have left? We have a vacuum, don't we? And the air pressure now from all the sides comes running in and sets off this molecular action, and then we hear thunder, right? But you see the lightning first because light travels faster than sun. Okay? Now, along with that, how fast does sun travel, Jim? Okay, let's estimate something. 700 miles an hour, 750? Okay, all right, about 1,110 feet per second. Okay, so if you see the lightning and then you hear the thunder, you count about 1,100 feet per second, depending on the altitude and also depending on the heat of the day, then we know about how far away the lightning gets. But sound travels that same way. If it's thunder, it travels the same way as it is. If it's a bass drum, it travels the same way as this, and all this other thing. Now, a few years ago, there was a clinician that was from the Conn factory, and he was a very good friend of mine, and he'd gotten his job of teaching how to blow notes out of the trumpet. And he wanted to do a clinic down in Bloomington, and Tom Biggs was quite drunk up there. And so we thought, well, let's get this guy down and do this thing. At that time, I was doing a lot of studying down in the physics department, and so he was talking, telling the kids how to blow notes out of the trumpet. So after the lecture, we all went out and had a beer and all that stuff, and it was great. But in the meantime, I had said, is it okay, Jody, if I have the physics department from the University of Manhattan, the physics department, bring these equipment down, and let's talk about this other aspect of this thing. And he said, sure, that'd be just fine. So we did. So there was a man by the name of Harold Iverson that played with Columbus before, Columbus, Ohio, Orchestra, and he went to school. I knew he was in school at that time. He was a student there. So, two fellows came down from the physics department, and what I said was, now what I want you to do is, I want you to measure the distance of the tuba from the mouthpiece to the bell, but not as if there was a bell. So he measured the distance of the tuba, and then he had a kind of a little plastic tube that was about a quarter of an inch around. And I said, what I want you to do is, I want you to put this in the corner of your mouth, Carol, when you blow that little note. Be flat, and then one of the people in this department measured the air pressure of that, and from that they can compute the speed that the air goes through the horn. So when he played this sustained this note, we were asking these people to compute that. And he said, yes, we can compute that, and it takes about 6 seconds for the air go completely through a tuba and come out the bell. Now I said, we have trombone players now, and a trombone player's length is half the distance of a tuba. So if the air is going at the same speed, it's going to take the air 3 seconds to get out of the horn. Now if the trumpet is the half the length of the trombone, now it's going to take 3 seconds for the air to go from the mouthpiece through the horn. That's if they're playing that low note. Okay? So now I said on top of that, we're going to have a band. And this band is going to go down the road, and they're going to play one of Susan's marches. Dum, dum, ta-dum, bum, 120. Now, going 120, you have the tuba player's going to have to go down the road 12 steps, right? The trombone player goes down 6 steps, and the trumpet player goes down 3. municipality are you going to have in students in order to get this band together, right? So that kind of changed his thinking around, and he came up afterwards, Troy, he was at that time just working. He was pretty darn important, good working, I think that you may call. And so he said, well, Billy, he said, you know, I think I'm going to be what you know, that this department tries to bring that out. Well, we know now that sound travels that way, and we cannot blow a note out of a trumpet or brasses. And then people will say, well, what good is it to talk about that? I mean, you know, is that going to help to produce the sound there? The only thing that we say that about that is now we move the air to the sound that's in the horn instead of trying to blow it out. And maybe that will make things just a little bit easier for us. And at the same time that I was in school, I had a master's degree in theory and a master's degree in composition for music. So I had about 65 hours, I guess, for a doctorate degree. But I was really interested in psychology, so I only liked about 10 hours of psychology. And so this all became very interesting for me, especially when I studied yoga and studied Aikido. And so I thought, well, maybe it would be a good idea to apply some of the principles of this business of psychology to the instrument and see if I can help improve my system of teaching and getting things across to the students. And I did to stand in front of a mirror and practice and give myself a dose of everything that every kid had. And I had a terrible time trying to get the kid to work the thing out by a physical response. We know that it takes great energy and great strength to play, but I was kind of having trouble doing that. And so I happened to run into a psychiatrist one time, and we were talking about this thing, and he said, hey, Bill, he said, I think it'd be really interesting for you to study some Gestalt theory of psychology. So I got started on this thing, and we had a man in the university there, who was first there, that had played with the Berlin Philharmonic. He was a bass fiddle player. So when the Berlin Philharmonic team was looking to its first year there in 1946, Horace Eichler, who was the first trumpeter of the orchestra, wanted to meet the brass play teachers in the university because he was teaching at the conservatory over there in Berlin. So we got interested and we got started. And he was the one that really got me interested in Gestalt theory of psychology. Does everybody understand what the basic Gestalt is? No. The basic Gestalt is that the sum of all the parts is more than the whole. And that one sensory activity can knock out another sensory activity without the person that's behind that knowing what happens to it. And we'll go to you this morning. And to have to tell me what your senses are.
Your physical body is around?
Yeah.
Hearing, sight, taste, touch.
Smile, yeah. All right. And of course, the sixth sense, what is the sixth sense? Common. Okay. Now, what we try to do is we try to have some means of, you know, Bob Shue, I've never had the pleasure of meeting you, but I've heard your performance and enjoyed it so much. And I would like to have you come down here and go to the psychology. Would you do that for me? I've had many students that have been at this man's clinics and enjoyed it so much, Bob. So I would like to have you read that and count the number of F's in it as it goes along. If you would, then
it's in about that.
Well, you can borrow mine too. If you're not, you don't have to read it out. I'll get the reading count the F's and go on. I'd like it. Would you come down to me? Have you played football in?
Yep.
We'll go on down.
Thank you.
Three, okay, so, that's okay, I'm gonna let you sit down. We'll talk about that in a minute. All right, now, that, now, Bob is really honest about that. He saw three F's. Now, I can tell you a story, Bob. Being very careful, Bob, you know. No, I'm just, okay, so, he saw three F's, and so did you. Now, how did you bring me out? You saw that, and you knew that was A?
Just by memory.
How did you know it was memory? By the sound of it, that's right. You learned that by the sound of that. So when you read something, you're reading the sound, right? Okay, now, when you get to the A, B, C, D, E, F, when you get to F, you don't pronounce full F, up. You pronounce full V. So your sensory activity of hearing knocks out your saving. I'll go back through there and see if you can find any OFs or kind of those things. OFs. How many? Try it again.
Hey, this is an intelligence test.
Shut the music down. She said, I want you to play it. She said, you can't see it, you can't wait until you do see it. Because seeing thing was not enough character for that cross business with that century activity. Okay, so we got going there, and so she played it slowly, and she said, I don't think I can get all the way through. And I said, well, let's try it. So she did. She was able to go, just start out and imagine you're doing it. She did. And it went fine. And then she picked it up and played right through it. She didn't have any problem with it. She didn't have any trouble falling apart. I mean, she did. Like off her account back there. Double C's and federal C's and all that stuff. And we cleaned up. That's great. So, but anyway, she was able to do it. And I said, here we have. We've worked for 45 minutes for an hour. And now you can play this. You've been working for 2 weeks trying to get your tuck and tuck and tuck. So this business of sound thing is pretty important. And sensory activity is so important. Sometimes we don't see what we see. Sometimes we don't hear what we hear. Were you here yesterday?
Oh,
that's where that came from. Look at it very carefully. fenced out here, there's just those who do not, this door here, there's a black guy, there's a black chick. You see that cow? Now, you'll never forget that cow. No, you won't. They see this, wait, a year from now, they say, they pop right out at you. Yeah, black here, black guy, gold, his body was here, bring them side to me.
So, did you see that thing?
Yeah, come on up.
No, I just went there, that's fine.
What's that?
Just, we haven't been able to see it, not yet.
Oh, listen, that's, we can pass it around, sure.
I'm glad I didn't have seen it.
So when Ernst Hoffman came to came from his, the play, the concert down there, the opening number was the Brandenburg chairman, Trump. And at that time, of course, I had put it off hard, had to anchor his phone behind his feet, right, in order to talk, pronounce these notes. And people would ask me, well, why don't you say, boy, wait, why can't I? That's what I'm going to do. Well, he had a problem. Okay, that guy's tongue is so long, he can break his nose. So he had to figure out a way to pronounce that sound. And the only way that he could do it is to get rid of some of that stuff he had in his mouth and put it on the tongue. So that was the natural thing for him to do, was to go through the sound thing. So that's what produced those three. Now, we know that if we hear what we hear like that, it's just like double thing. There was a book many years ago that came out. I hope none of you guys wrote this. So happens that you know. But anyway, the way to learn the double thing is to go two. Do you remember that? Okay. Well, you pronounce that stuff, boy, you've got more problems than tires down hill. So you pronounce the double thing, and you pronounce the sound that you want to come out of that horn. And that is the paramount, thing what we get. Sound. That's all we're paid for. In 1975, the first International Trumpet Guild was formed at Indiana University. And I think that the big boy behind the Trumpet Guild was Harvey Phillips. And Charlie Brown was into that sort of stuff, and they said, well, what we want to do, Bill, we don't have any money to bring in too many people from the outside in this thing, but would you play and would you do this thing the way you think trumpet should be activated? And I thought about it, and I said, boy, I don't know about that, because there's a lot of people who don't want to believe this, and I don't want anybody to believe it either. I mean, look at it, try it out, and the darn thing works. Use it. If it doesn't work, why, you know, with all the intelligence that's in this room, we have to look at everything. We need every doggone crutch. We need everything we can do to improve our performance and improve that sound. So after Bacchiano had called and Joe Alessi and a few other people, I decided, well, I'd be there. So I got a call from one of my kids to play in Philadelphia Orchestra, and he said, there's a teacher here in Philly that has got a very special way to play the trumpet, and he said, I don't think that he's going to agree with you. So I said, well, that's okay. So I think this lecture is dressing, like the rest of about an hour and a half, and I played the violin, and it was all over the world. And this man is a very personal guy, and he came up. He said, boy, I enjoyed everything that you did, but I can't believe a thing that you said. And I said, well, boy, that's great, because we're in America. We live in America. We can do it. And you've got to follow your own drummer. You've got to follow your own drummer. And say, for example, if Bobby Shue now sounded like Adolf Herzen, and every trumpet player in the world sounded like Adolf Herzen, you can go to one concert and hear the whole crew, right? So thank God that Bobby sounds like he sounds, and Charlie sounds like he sounds, Doc sounds like he sounds, Marie sounds like him. It gives us room for ourselves. We have room now that we can come up with maybe a different interpretation or a different sound, so that's what we're after with this music. Well, this man came along and said that he couldn't do it. I said, well, why don't you try it for just a little while and see what happens? And after you've done this, why don't you write me a card? If it doesn't help, well, throw it away. If it does help, why, that's fine. But if it doesn't help, send me a notice, and I'll send you a 75 cent to get into this right here so that you won't be out of it. Okay? So 6 months later, this guy came to the door, and he said, well, Billy said, I want to spend the afternoon with you. And I said, well, boy, I don't have that kind of time today. And I said, I'm not sure that you would students. And so he said, well, I'm going to settle for an hour. He said, would you do everything I ask you to do? And I said, boy, you bet. For that, I would be very happy to, if I could stand on my head and blow that thing, I'd love to do it. And he said, well, he said, you made a statement that you don't bust the mouthpiece. And I said, you got it, but I don't bust the mouthpiece. And he said, well, can you bust the mouthpiece? And I said, well, sure, I can bust the mouthpiece. So I grabbed a hold of the mouthpiece and I said, is this what you wanted? He said, that's the way you play the trumpet. That's the way you blow the trumpet. I said, no, that is not the way I play. But I will tell you this, if I were a mouthpiece brother, boy, I'd practice the hell out of this song. So he said, well, would you produce for me through the mouthpiece what you do when you play the trumpet? Sure. I said, sure. He said, well, all I hear is air going. And I said, well, that's just about the way it works. And so we got for further discussion. I said, well, you know, you can take a venturi to the lead pipe. The venturi tube is that part that is expanded here. This is a tuning pipe receiver, and this is the mouthpiece receiver. And you can put the mouthpiece in the tube like that, and you do the same thing. And he said, yeah, but you're buzzing your lips. You're making, you're buzzing your lips. I said, no, I'm not. I said, now I can take the mouthpiece like this and go through this thing, and if I'm forcing enough to hit the hole here, you see what happens. So he picked up the mouthpiece and... And he said, you need to tell me that your lips are not vibrating. And I said, I didn't say that. I didn't say that. He said, well, how's that possible? And I said, well, because of the shape of the mouthpiece, the life of that, so we go through this, which is here, and the molecules are banged tightly together in the mouthpiece, and at the end of this tube, and it sets up a standing wave, and the molecules are banging back and forth like this, and all of a sudden, practically, instantaneously, your lips vibrate sympathetically with what's happening on the inside. Well, boy, that is an advantage thing. He said, I've been thinking about that. He said, that's an advantage thing I've heard. And he said, do you have any further proof of that? That's pretty hard to do. And this guy was one of the guys on the string, you know. And so here a while back, there were some nice guys from L.A. and Hollywood and like that. One of them was Charlie Baker, you know, some of those guys like Jerry Hay and all those guys, you know, Gary Grant and, you know, Larry Hall. And they sent me the perfect view. Do you have a perfect view? You don't? You don't have one either? How many of your people own a perfect view? That's the way to go. Alright? Now what you do is you use this mute, okay, before you go to the job. And when you're on the job and you're playing and it says passive, then you use the mute. In between blues you use the mute, after the job you use the mute. And if you're fortunate to have anything left, before you go to bed. And now you use the mute, you pull out the cork and fill it full of vodka. So, of course, the reason I brought the mute was not to thank Charlie and all the guys for the mute, but you never used the mute ever, have you? Anyway, you can take this mute now, and you can put it up to your top and blow across it. Does everybody hear anything? You do. The molecules are banging back and forth in here. activated and going, you know where that sucker's going, okay? Now, if you do that enough, and you blow across that like this, would you say I'm busting my lips? Am I busting my lips? No. All right? Well, I can feel those lips buzzing. Now, by that right order, we be mean that the breath support does not come before playing the sound. It doesn't make the sound. The same thing that makes the sound is the sound of your mind. And when you have a pronunciation, we don't ever think about the tongue. I mean, we know that's how it's been, but it's done recently, other things. And take the two IE system, for example. No doubt that there is a certain movement in the tongue, but the tongue should be activated as a result of hearing the sound, and not the cause of that sound. Anybody follow that? And there was an article, Adolf Ritter, who's a good friend of mine, and a wonderful, wonderful trumpet player. And we were at the factory, the Bach factory, many years ago, and Marie St. Andre was there. And so we got talking and he was saying, you know, Billy said, if I ever played an audition like I played in the orchestra, nobody had ever heard me. And he said, boy, he's got to go that way. But sometimes the audition is one, you know, finding that you really didn't think you were going to do something. And then he asked me, about how I told him I was doing it. And he said, well, what do you do with certain things? And I said, well, Adolf, I can't do that. And he said, that's right. He said, anytime there is analysis, other than musical analysis, sound, there's paralysis. And boy, that sucker was set in just as. Sometimes we can have as much physical support as you can stir up, but it comes as a result of playing the note. And as long as it's the result of playing the note, you're in good shape. But if you try to sit it up sometimes, like if you're a certain way that your tongue will, if you stick your tongue against your teeth and push a little bit, the first thing you know, it's a muscle. You've got, it's swelled up. There's so much in there, there ain't no room for error. So you get into all of those things that make this trumpet thing. And so if we can hear the sound, pronounce the sound, and we pronounce it mentally, then everything will take place. In other words, we have a few little things we do to start out. We can take a big breath, and if you immediately pronounce sound, the sound will be there. Why not? Now the next thing we want to get into here is this business of reading tension. I know all you people in here that read like cross-eyed black snakes and don't have any trouble, but I've had some trouble with that business of reading tension. So it does some funny things to my business of this talk. And I would say that the majority of the people that I know are in that pot. When they first introduced the music, trumpet players from all the ways of the world. We take, for example, the trumpet. The teacher will say, now, these are five lines, this is a treble flat. And that second line up there is G. And they invite a circle underneath the G. Okay? Now that's trained, the hip already in an activity that he shouldn't be trained. So then they say this next note is F sharp, and that's on that first space. Now you have to push the second button down, so you have the F sharp. And F natural, now it's a third one. So what is this kid doing? What he is reading music through seeing and not through hearing. And so that is one of the things that I think I was very fortunate to have teachers when I didn't have that on the mind. He taught me to hear that. Does everyone know a man by the name of Earl Garner? Does that mean anything to anybody? There was a piano teacher at Indiana University, and his name was Mannheim Kester. And by the way, he's a pretty famous, very wonderful piano player. So Jerry goes and he plays, never was out some beautiful thing, and Mannheim was telling me that he's the only guy that can win the game. The first time through, he was there. And so, maybe the man who developed these ears to such a great extent that that century activity has got to be done. So when we see a note, if we can hear that pitch of that note that's on the page, and now let that be our guide. That can be caused by two things. You know, that can be caused because you stayed up too late last night, which I would hope would be the case, or that thing can become.
No.
But so that, so that we go to that. Now we also want to remember that we're going to put all the rhythm of the tune. You know, how many of you have ever played with that group? And all of a sudden the rhythm is just like the music should be. Until you start to beat your point, you're going to play harder to get the thing lined up. And where does it go? It goes down to done. Or you're playing a lot of somebody, and somebody's so out of tune that you can't stand. And so you point out, you know, and of course what happens, the kinesthetic responses form in a different kind of way. Or you're playing with a bunch of guys at the rhythm of the band, you have to start beating your foot. If you start beating your foot, you're going to beat your brains up. Because your brains are in your feet right now. You're trying to set up that. You have to set up music. Now, I think that we can open this up for discussion just a little bit. If anybody has any questions you'd like to ask, or I can have them answer. Or if there's anything that... anybody have any questions to ask? Yes. Okay, all right. First, you want to, oh, by the way, that brings up another thing, too. And you know, with all of us, with all the people, Jefferson is an organization, and like I did a thing here, years ago, and one of the performers was a man by the name of Starker. Things that it talks about in there is self-image out. And when we talk about self-image, is that how do we feel about ourselves? How do we feel about ourselves? Do you feel confident? Do you feel all these other things? We know that when you perform sometimes, there's something there, buddy, at least there's for me. And so people would ask me, how do you feel? I have something to say. I said, well, I'm all upset, ready to go. That's about the way that thing goes. So you get in here and it talks about the self-image a little bit, and you practice it as a big time. says here, if you do the same, you would have to talk. But therefore, you actually have to get your head where it's going to be. And this means you ask me, this fellow over here is asleep. It has to be about the zone. You let yourself get into the sound so much that you are consumed with sound. And like reading a good book, you get in there and you're a lawyer, you're a lover, you're a human drunk, or whatever, they're doing it, and all of a sudden, an hour and a half gone by, you just shut the book up, and an hour and a half gone by, you feel like you're doing something. That's what we're talking about, getting into that sound. And I would say that today, I sometimes have the feeling that we are going for lots of notes. We're going for lots of things. I'm going to say something that I hope no one will hold against me. That there's a Trump player who went by the name of Maynard Curtis. Maynard Curtis was one of my ideals at one time. This guy in the 30s, 60s, and the 50s, and he played in the low register so beautifully, the music was so beautifully, it was unbelievable. He'd play out of the register. course I turned, but that's one time I played the first time. When we played the phrase a certain way, I did not play that phrase that way. If the pitch is a little high on an open pitch or something like that, I'm going to raise that up so that that's how the first game is going to be possible. Because I know if I make my part the most musical thing that I can make, not with the style of any out of field, but with the style of the person who's doing this thing, I know that my ball is going to play easier, I know that it's going to sound better, and I know that we're going to send a lot of music to people. And if you've ever been to Berlin, you've never been there, but Bob tells me that the Lions to buy tickets for the Berlin Philharmonic this season 2 or 3 days ahead of time. Is that right? So when we're playing music, singing music, we take a man like Matthew Hope, for example. Boy, the guy can chew his song, the phrase, unbelievable. But if you hear an isolated sound, Matthew Hope, that is like a he's making music. He's making music. And I think that's the thing that we're after. We're after making music. Making that sound good. Well, I don't think I have a heck of a lot else to say. Any questions?
Okay. So, I'm going to agree with how I feel all day back to
you. Oh, sure. Okay, now, what we do is we play as a trumpet the same cockeyed line. What we do is we'll have to do this because we're going to play. Okay. And what we're going to do now is we're going to take your fingers like this, okay? And play them all around the room. What are you doing? Are you aware that your wrists are moving, your arms are moving, your head's moving, your hands moving around, all this stuff is happening? You know, you're not. Those are kinesthetic responses to a thought. Okay. Now, you can take those fingers like this, and I want you to point those fingers this at me. Okay? Now I'm pointing at me. Now you're going to slowly, as slowly as you can, bring those fingers together. Okay? Real slowly bring them together. That's a modified isometric action. What is an isometric? Muscle against muscle. So we got muscle going against muscle. Now that's one way to bring those fingers together, right? Now there's another way to bring those fingers together. Take those fingers and point them at me and relax your mind and your physical system, keeping your energy ready, and repeat after me everything I say and do not look at your fingers. Okay? My fingers are coming together. 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 So that's your fingers. They come together. Okay? Now, go back to this handshake thing again. Okay? What happens? You know I'm going to squeeze it, but you are modifying isometrics. These muscles are pulling in this way. These are holding back this way. And they can only go so far. I have a lot further to go this way. Okay? So if you get a line into that sound, we know it takes great energy. And so there's no doubt about it, there's a lot of physical response to that. But if we set up our physical response first, sometimes we activate muscles that we don't need. No one's questioning this about breath support and the lack of this either, but it comes as a result of the music. Yeah, I mean, because everybody, you've got to do this, you've got to do that. Now, I'm not saying that a lot of the things that are in the books are not true. They are. But sometimes the results are made causes, and the cause to get the result gets mixed up. If you read the book of Control the Plan by Rafael Mendez comes out. Boy, listen, that guy can double tongue and triple tongue and circular breathe and fingers all over the line like you have never heard. Really. And then he was asked to write a book, and he wrote the book, and in the book on breathing, it says what you do, now, you create a vacuum in your lungs, and the air will rush in. And my answer to that is, if you really understand what a vacuum is, if you had a vacuum in your lungs, my friend, you'd be dead. There would be hole. You would be dead. So, we have that kind of thing going on. And he says, you hold your arm, you're this way, you do this to them. No doubt that that is the result, but it is not the cause. The cause of that is that sound. So we get into all these crazy things, you know, about how we orientate these things. And you go back to sound. If you're a combo player, listen to Tommy Dorsey. Boy, oh boy. That guy can play. And you hear that sound, and you know immediately what he does. And that's one of the things that Dr. Marvin does in the mouthpiece. I was there for a while, and I first came out here, and I talked to him one time, and I said, do you remember what's the mouthpiece?
Trouble getting from, like, say, slurring from, say, a C up to an open C to open E. What would you do to tell him to do that if he's having trouble with that?
Okay. How long did this young man play?
Well, he's a beginner.
Can he get over the horn a little bit?
What's that?
Can he get over the instrument a little bit?
When he can tongue, but he can get it out, but he always has to slip his tongue in to get it. And for the life of me, I don't know what to tell him.
Well, what we do, the first thing we do is I always go back to this thing because I think there are 40 samples, 11 samples, but we flat out? What's flat out mean to you? As hard as you can? Okay, well, all right. Well, that's why I say that you can't write a book on flight instructancy. If I wrote in a book and I said you play flat out, and you interpret it to play as hard as you can, well, then there's, see, then you're not reading what I had in mind, and I'm not able to say what I have in mind so that you can understand it. So that's the reason that we don't write books on this. So what I usually do is have the kids go to two, and when we play flat out, we mean that the mind is focused in one place, and we play through that focus, and that focus never changes. It's there. The notes don't go up, and the notes don't go down. The notes are faster in vibration and slower in vibration, but we don't think up and we don't think down when we play. And the reason for that is if we do that, if you, we're getting into some things that are pretty complicated, and I'm not sure I can get enough to talk to students, but we'll mention this. In your larynx, right through here, your front system here, the opening at the top is narrower than the middle, and the opening at the bottom is narrower than the middle. And if you think that's right, I never suggest to do our ESA, because sometimes a guy will, that doesn't mean we don't use those vowels sometimes. That doesn't mean that we, that this happens as a result. You understand what I'm saying? But if we do that, then the whole larynx box will go up this way and choke. And the first thing you activate it is the And when you do that, you activate your grunt muscle. Okay? So when I hear a kid play, I never tell him that that's what that is. Because if you get his head stuck in that, man, he's not really up. He's not correct that, but you can't miss that. So what we do is we have him play and think flat out. In other words, we make sure that we are floating the sound on air. Air is our energy. We float the sound on the breath. So we would have that in the cell up. And we get that going to the point that we can hear that sound, and the red thing comes along, and we don't have to do too a heck of a lot with that. And then if we're having, if we, at once we get that thing accomplished, once we accomplish that, then we do, well, all the time we play the routine, we play these long notes, just like that, to get our heads into this business of flat out. Are everybody understanding what I'm saying? Okay, so we play it. And we play through that thing until it's flat out, until, and of course, another thing we do when we warm up, we're trying to warm up the sound in our mind. We're trying to get the air to go through this sound that we hear. And when you first pick up the horn and do like that, that's not exactly the sound that you're looking for. But you have to, like the cow, you have to find that sound. And I probably won't have it here for, you know, like 6 minutes. But then when you play through that, then you play through the sound. You play the sound through that. And then you're asked the question of playing from C to E or playing an arpeggio or anything like that. You're playing through the instrument, and all those notes are mentally focused in the same place. Like an example, you go. Thank you. But those notes aren't there. Pedal seats on the floor and double seats on the high ceiling. Baloney. All those notes are there. All those notes are there. And all you have to do in the way of business of pronunciation, you know, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't say, make that sucker drink unless you sold him. You know, so you have to somehow or other try to turn your own thinking into a position where he is going to grab what you've got to say or what he can hear. So you have to make him hear. And that's why I'm always so interested in, gosh, listen to Chuck Finney, listen to Gary Grant, listen to Jay Cole up here, listen to Greg Wings and all these guys, listen to Charlie Davis, listen to Bobby Schumann, and you, all of you, listen to them and gather the things that they're doing. And with all the performers that can play, their basic thing is there. They may have a different concept of what you need. And they may have a different hold to this. That doesn't mean that it's not good, but if they feel it and they can express music, that's what they're after. That's what they're after. And then, along with that, your mind cannot be stopped on one note. You know, the mind has to move to the phrase, and it has to be in motion. If the mind is not in motion, everything is stopped. If you hear the sound, you continue to think the movement of that sound, then you're in good shape. But you think, then it's stopped, and it's not going to go. And the same thing with whether it's a slur or whether it is. You can gear your head in the same place where it's going to be flat out, then many things happen. And there's one other thing I want to tell you too. To change a modified isometric action to a kinesthetic response, the minimum amount of time is between 2.5 to 3 years to get the sucker started. So don't think that it can't happen to you. Keep working on it. And as you work on it, and as you work on your imagination, things will then open up for you. And then when that opens up for you something else, you'll get a better picture of the cow, or you'll get a better thing of sound. You go and go back to that thing of purchasing thing and see what happens to people. I'm sure it can happen to anyone. I hope that I never let them. I hope that I get to a place where it doesn't happen. But when you get to the place like Maynard, you can also hard to say it so well, then he becomes important. Are you following what I'm saying? If he becomes important now, and he's showing off his ego, which is how, I'm not saying this is all private, but for example, the ego thing to show it off. If you ever put that thing on the table, we'll do that for you. But, yeah, if that becomes important, and music is not important, then that's when this other thing. Saying like nobody in the world when she was young. And really make their heart go. And then people find out that they're important. And then they try to find what they lost. They go to do, they go to go, they go to do, they go. All kinds of crazy things. And try to find the thing that they lost. And the only thing they lost is music. Yes.
When you're teaching, it seems like you're always trying to approach it from purely musical, from that direction. Do you ever talk to someone specifically about timing or a particular, do you give any advice on that, or do you always try to approach it purely musical?
I think I always try to approach it through sound.
You never address a specific problem.
Not physically. Not physically. What I do is, I'll play a note, the kid will play it. And if the phrase isn't quite right, we have a trombone player. And she she was getting some couple of calls, and they knew, are you acquainted with the Kibbutz sisters any of these? They all fund the room, some fund the room, two old the room, two young the room, and the tone comes out, a little bit, all right? Well, what that can come from sometimes is thinking of putting a tongue in a certain position or articulation in a certain position. But if you think, just like that, and at the end of the lesson, did it feel any different, sweetheart? Sure, it feels different. I mean, no. And it sounds different, too. So, depending on what the music demands, what are the demands of music, will depend on what you think.
Yeah. Guys, these guys have to change their tapes. They want to run the tapes.
You sure you want to continue this stuff?
Why? Anybody else have questions?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Bob.
Well, wait
till you're in college.
Caruso, that's interesting. If you read the book about Enrico Caruso, it says in the book that he went to the doctor, and the doctor looked him all over, and he said, you will never sing. You do not have the throat of the vocal cords of the singer. And at the end of the book, it says, you don't have to have the vocal cords for the mouth of a singer. You have to have the mind of a singer. And if you've ever heard of that, the way that people sing, or Mario Alonso, amazing. And there was another, I think you want me to tell him about the little car. Yeah, this is an interesting thing. I have a grandson that was a, I don't know how he ever got this, brains. And so he would go to school, you know, and come home with straight A's all the time. Never crack a book, never do anything. And he would come home with straight A's. Well, he was selected out of two or three students there to go to the space camp down in Alabama. That's when he was in junior high school. And he'd been studying drums a little bit. But this little guy was lazy. I mean, he was. He just thought that I could do it. I mean, the bellman, right? So I finally had the bellman hunter. I said, this guy's driving me crazy. I can't do it. So he started, by the way, he started great. He started to study with Mickey. Okay. Alright. And I'm sure that Mickey's over here and he's going to ask too. But anyway, he went to space camp, and when he came back from space camp, he said, Grandpa Dewey, he said, I want to tell you something. That those guys down there in space camp have talked about the same thing that you talked about. And I said, well, how do you know that? He said, well, when I first walked into that first lecture, this, the man conducting the lecture, standing at the door, handed me this card. He got this from the voice. I'd like to have you read that card to everybody, would you?
Obstacles are what you see when you take your eyes off the goal.
Obstacles are what you see when you take your eyes off the goal. Take your ears out of the sound, that's where the problems are. Okay. Is that going to make you happy, Charlie? All right. Now, Bob, what do you have something to
look at? Well, basically, it's around the, we just went right into what I was going to ask you about. It. All the teaching that I do is very much parallel to what you do, but one of the problems I run into with a lot of kids is opposite changes, where either through damage, I've had a few kids in automobile accidents and lost all the teeth.
Yeah.
Broken nose and things like that. And because of physical damage to the muscles, they don't work the same way scar tissue.
Sure.
And that, and plus the fact of ones that just really have, for whatever reason, which is a long story, but when they get into a screwball setup where you've got the mouthpiece sort of tucked into the membrane down here, you're not involved with the muscle. And I see an awful lot of kids that when they come to me for a lesson and so forth, and I see it and I go, oh no. I know, suddenly know I'm underpaid, you know. But I wanted to know. I mean, the point is that I think I feel the same way as you do. I sort of like, I want to do the best I can, which is pull your hair out, hoping you can get them through that. And I do the same sort of things with talking about sound and, you know, thinking about
sure.
Music, essentially. But, I mean, have you run into any, like, really special little secrets about...
I've never run into anything like that. You wouldn't believe it. Do you have your drum in here, Bob Burns?
Is it
Bob Burns here?
It's in the Bob.
Would you go get that for you?
What's your case, Bob?
Here that's kind of interesting. Okay. There's another fellow that ran into some. This particular guy played with Tom Jones, and he played with Buddy Rich and a bunch of people like that, you know. And he was playing tennis with a beautiful girl one day. And so he threw his racket up in the air, don't you know, and it fell down, and he tripped himself on the racket and bashed his head in. And so here is this young fellow back here, Jay Hogan. He's here this morning. You know, he ran into a serious problem. Like I said, of course, you know, you always tell these stories to make a nice story out of that person. It's not that much, except for he was a mom. He had stopped at the cabin. He had stopped at the cabin, and we were going through a bunch of stuff, and we like that, and we were talking about some other things. And today, I would like to have you repeat to these guys today what happened when I was putting the tape. Could you tell them about that?
Sure. Well, Mr. Adams' cabin has like two sides to it. I was trying to play with another student, Jim Reed. And I just couldn't get any noise out of the corner at all because I had three different people in front. And Mr. Adam came walking around the corner with a spatula in one hand and a hot pad in his other hand. Well, how do you listen? Don't even think about your corners. They're there, but just don't think about it. Just blow through the sound, and the next time I played, it was just a great note came out. He was in the other room.
It's amazing what you do, what your ears can do for you. I got to tell you about this guy here. Bob came to school. Bob came to school, and I already had signed up. You know, my teaching load at the university was supposed to be 15 hours a week. That was to include playing with the quick bit and doing some of these other things. And most often, I don't think I ever read it. I didn't have 35 or 40 students that I'd signed up for. And I was loaded up like you wouldn't believe. And this young man, he never knocked at the door. And there was a, I had a trombone player, a wonderful name was Tillman Buck. You remember Tillman? Okay. But I don't know what Tillman told this guy, but it must have been possible. But anyway, Bob came to the door and knocked. And he said, I'm done studying with you, okay? And I said, well, there's no way that I can take you. I said, look, the whole time, I'm teaching from morning to night, and a lot of times I start at 8 o'clock in the morning and go home at 5 o'clock at night for a sandwich or something like that. I go back afterwards, and we have a master class for an hour on Monday or something like that. Brass part was usually Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and I get through about 10 o'clock, and then I go home, and we kind of move out. But anyway, I said, there's no way I can take you. And so, he left, and I was busy, or something like that. And the next morning, bang, 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 who do you suppose at the door? Bob Burns. And he said, I'm a hard worker, Mr. Adams, and I'm going to study with you. And I said, well, I can't do that. This went on for about 10 days. And Cheryl Shaw came in one morning, I guess it was about 8 o'clock, banged at the door, and he said, I'll do anything you tell me to do, Mr. Adams, and I'm a hard worker, and I really am. Well, I said, Bob, I guess we got to go. So Bob and I came together. And now you probably couldn't tell you what his armature was like. I can tell you a lot of things. But he was playing double Einsetzen. You know what Einsetzen is?
Yeah.
Yeah. The top lip was this, the lower lip was that, and he stuck it in there like that. He probably doesn't remember all this because he probably never did thank me for setting up his armature or his breath or anything like that. Most of the guys don't. And thank the goodness they don't. They always thank you for, well, you know, what's in between your ears. Are you warmed up at all, Bob? All right. Would you start on second G and play for E G? Just an octave up and back, kind of easy for me. Got any double C's in there? These guys don't need sense, neither do I. Okay? And what do you suppose he's thinking?
Fame. Anyway, you know, you run into these guys like that, all my students, you know, the thing that makes a pretty good teacher is good students. No kidding. And so I've had some of that time. So I'd be very, very happy about that. And I think sometimes we don't really know how well blessed we are until we've been through the life process. So it's just one thing that way. But there are, there are things that I do, but it's all done with some. So there's some things that, for example, I'm not sure the students will hear some of this stuff. Say some of these things, and then the kid will hopefully say, man, that's what's the matter with me. So you start working on stuff like that. Now, I had studied with a guy by the name of Pappy Mitchell and Hiram Lammers, and I took a few lessons with Lou Maggio. And when Pappy Mitchell couldn't take me, I would deal with the high, and then I would deliver a few times with Maggio. And so I went in there and played for him the first time, and I said, you know, at the second lesson, I said, well, why in the world aren't you having me play pentacles? He said, what for? What for? Why would you play pentacles? You don't need to play pentacles. I said, I know, but look at all these other guys here. Well, they've got a specific problem that we're trying to solve. And when you play pentacles, it's not how you play pentacles. That's how you do it. And sometimes when there is no position strength, you know what we're talking about. When there's no position strength and the sound is way back in your mouth, you know, like you hear some of these opera singers, you get the place that they have swallowed so much of that stuff, that sound, you know. And then when you hear someone like fighting a barrel or a hell of trouble or somebody like that that sticks it right up front, gee, the whiz, that's what we're after. So we do many, many things. If a guy is the grunt muscle is activated and the throat is tight and the tongue is tight and the air is tight and it's squeezed and all that sort of stuff, we slowly start doing some silly exercises that will help that thing along. And one of the exercises we do is known as a bending exercise. Now when you think of bending, you think of bending something, don't you? Well, we think of bending sound, but leaving the sound in exactly the same place. And sometimes if you do this, this will move the muscular activity to the front of the face a little bit. And it oftentimes will change where the mouthpiece rides. So you stay up at night and you stand in front of the mirror and you give yourself a dose of everything that every kid has, and you try
ways to get it so that you can say it to the student so he understands what you're trying to say. And that's the most difficult thing is, am I telling the student what I know in a way that he will understand what I'm saying? Does that make any sense to you, though? In other words, and then when they don't grasp that, then you as a teacher have to go back and think some other things out to try to find ways in which you can take the thing that you want to happen to the student in his opposite problem or reading problem. Then you get into that. And so sometimes by bending, like you can play from G to F sharp just straight across the board. And by playing that way, you hear the sound and you have him push the button down, and all these funny little things from the amateur will take place. And then what you have him do is have him think the F sharp and play through the F sharp without any vowels. Now, we know it's ridiculous to play an F sharp without any vowels. I mean, that's pretty dumb, but if it'll help to move a muscular activity in an area that will help to open him up, then we do. And so if you, I know it's more than just one. So if you play that, sometimes you can try many things, and seeing Bob, this happy guy over here, why, all week long, it'd be just great to have several of the students come in with problems, and then oftentimes, the teachers will bring a student or something like that, like some of the former students have a teaching center, you know, talking about the previous thing, but the both of the people, and if this kind of is fighting currently, say, my gosh, I can't tell these kids what they're supposed to do. And the kid would come in and say something like that, he said, what do you think, as a matter of fact? I really have this. I said, well, you know what, I didn't talk to him, I forget. I forget, I get that sound in my mind and make sure that all this is good and relaxed, and there's nothing relaxed, and pronounce that sound. Well, she said, well, was there any way, she brought a particular tune in, she said, Nancy Adams, by the way, she brought a particular tune in, she said, could you help me? And here she was trying to say this, I can't remember the name, but do these things write on the board here? Will this write on the board again? All right. Let's take, for example, we have a tune such as the work as only make believe, right? And the first word now is that. That's what she's going to say. That's the next. That's the next one. Doesn't look like only make believe, does it? That's the next one. You say, how in the world can that be useful? And of course, the young lady was having trouble with getting the continence out. They were, she was choking. It had nothing to do with breath, but Eileen thought that that was what the problem was, and that meant to give some of those. So that made I saw get rid of the problem. I didn't solve the problem, but he didn't tell me about it. And so the tune goes like this. Only make believe I love you. And every vowel was sustained. We played the trumpet. We sustained the vowel. You don't think you get stuck with a pronunciation or something. And maybe the gal would come in four or five times and she would do it. It would be nice to talk to her. The most important thing was the wide awakeness of her eyes. She said, I'm not choked up anymore. I said, well, that's what I thought about it. So, I mean, you know, she married a policeman. She came down and gave me a picture. She said, I can't believe it. You've not been able to feel about the baby. You look for two less than that. I can teach you that more. So when we play the trumpet, we do the same thing. We pronounce that sound. I don't know if I can play this right off the hand, but it's a cool thing. Everybody play it for a little famous notes for the opening of the Holy Grail in the Parsifal, opera Parsifal. Let me blow it over. That's all right. Get all that junk out. house for 20% of the percent.
So many questions about mouthpieces that just drive me nuts. It's all, well, this cup, this rim, it just, you know, I'm at the point where it's just, I'm trying to prepare for my senior recital, and it's just driving me nuts. You know, you're talking about getting the sound, and I'm like, well, I like this player, but I'm on the C trumpet, I'm on the B flat, I'm in the E flat, and it's just, it's driving me nuts with the mouthpiece today. I don't know if you can...
Well, let me tell you what I do. For every trumpet that I own, and I have 50 of them, for every trumpet that I own, I use a different mouthpiece. I feel the resistance of the sound a little bit, which is basically, and then when I can get the sound that I'm after, then that's the mouthpiece. For this particular trumpet here, I'm playing a 5C mouthpiece. When I play one of my 229 mouth trumpets, I play one with a 1 straight one, and I play one with a 1B, and when I play the piccolo trumpet, one of my piccolo trumpets, I use the Bob Reeves mouthpiece, and the other one I use a 7E mouthpiece. As long as I can get the sound that I am after, then the physical response thing is not very difficult for me. But I think that we're getting to the thing today that people want to build trumpets to play themselves. And gosh, I had a kid in here a while back who came in and he had heavy metal caps down here, and he had tape wrapped around his holes. He had a sleeve over here. And I said to him, I said, well, what if you never said it before? I said, well, what's all that stuff about? He said, well, that helps your heart register. This guy couldn't play a piece of 9 plus a snap. So I said, I don't think it's helped your register. we got back to the basic thing, and I saw him just recently. He invited my wife and some of my friends to a show, and he played first trumpet and fifth around the rooftop. So, but this is after 5 years, you know, playing to get out of his tent, coming to the room. But I think that what you're talking about, if I would say that I would get a mouthpiece of steel tone for, and boy, I'd go after that sound. Boy, would I go after that sound. And I'd play things that, you know, that will develop that. But if you keep trying mouthpieces out all the time, you're going to be doing that the rest of your life. You don't want to be a mouthpiece coming out.